Okay, so Mikkel is also involved in the NOMAD project, and he's working at the Technical University of Denmark. And the topic is data quality and estimating errors on DFT calculations from high high quality reference calculations. Okay, please.
All right. Yes, so I'm talking about estimating and controlling errors in DFT calculations. So, as you see from this long list of authors, which I'm really standing on the shoulders on here, it's been a team effort within the NOMAD here. So, because it required calculation with different codes and so on, so. And it was actually relatively easy to do in this nice community here at NOMAD people. Let's start up with some history. So what you see here is essentially the history of calculations on very simple material silicon. You see the lattice parameter as a function of time. History starts when PD was born, 1996, and we end up here at present day. So what you can see is that the lattice constant as a function of time here is there's some scattering, there's different values. When you look at 2016, suddenly there's a lot of points here. So this was really a community effort where something like 30 codes or thereabouts was used to calculate the lattice constant, and you can see the spread is at least a little bit smaller than it used to be. So that means probably we can be relatively confident that the distance between the calculated values here and the experiment is now not numerical problems, but exchange correlation in a practice. So this was published in Science in last year. Of course, the people looked at more than just silicon for the Science paper. So this is generally referred to in the density DFT study, I think. So they looked at in 71 elemental solids with the PPE functional, and what one of the things they did was calculating energy versus volume curve, and then comparing two methods by looking at the difference in such two curves, okay, according to some measure which is called delta. So what this slide is supposed to illustrate is that codes, when they are sort of really converged with extreme numerical settings, much more than you would use in daily life, they can agree. So the green colors means there's a very good agreement, and in general this is the all electron codes, so the most precise one, so the best agreement with each other. And the yellow stuff is PW calculation, solar potential calculation, and the red ones here, which are in principle bad, are some old solar potential calculation that nobody does anymore. Okay, so in principle one can get these codes to agree with each other, but have to use really high numerical type settings, like really high basis settings. So this is good, but if you think about NOMAD, you know, and also daily life with DFT calculation, you don't use these settings. So you use finer basis set and finer, if you look at a solid K1 set, most of the time. So let's just take a very simple example. Let's say you were looking at in the NOMAD repository, you find two materials. This is the same material but two different phases. I call it T and A, so this is with sulfide. And then you can ask the question of, if you look up in the database, which one is the most stable? Okay. So that's very easy, you just look at which one has the lowest total energy, let's say that. So you subtract these two numbers and figure it out. But what happens if these two phases were calculated with different settings? So one was sort of a crude calculation, one was an accurate calculation. Can you then compare these numbers and so on? So this is sort of, generally I think if you search in NOMAD, you can get a lot of data, but how can you compare them, or how much you can trust these numbers when you compare them? And of course numerical settings are many things in codes, but we'll just focus on basis set and we'll also examine in this topic. And of course if we have some information on these errors, we could feed them into everything you do on top. Like machine learning, you can have include that you have some uncertainty in your data that you try to fit on. Or you can simply say, okay, I'm only interested in data that are certainly quality. So you can discard, let's say, everything that is not converged to within 25 millimeters or whatever you like. And of course, this is nice. We will look at actually calculating these errors, but of course, it would be much more practical if you can also estimate, because you don't want to calculate these errors for all 44 million entries in the normative. This is what I'm going to talk about. So this is the rest of the plan here. So first, what materials or what data set did we look to take to do this higher accuracy calculation for and then look at errors? And when we these two sources of errors, like weightings and a K-point sampling. So I'll talk about errors in total entities and relative entities. We looked at much more, but I don't have time to talk about that today. And then this is just looking at how it goes for the codes, and then we will try to do some simple estimation of the errors. And finally, there's a bit of outlook of the other part of the error there, which is not the numerical, but the exchange correlation error. And then conclusions and a little bit about this analytics error bundle that can be made if you want to go in yourself and then play with all this data. So what did we look at? So we took the 71 elemental solids from this density T study and extended that with some binary solids. It was 82, so this was John, who was part of it here, who sat down, looked up in Springer materials for experimental binaries, generally took the most stable ones, and then we selected 82. And then in the end, that's a sort of a, so these were sort of selected by us. So that's a kind of a test. Small test data set, we took 10 random ternary solids from the NOMAD database and tested what we found in the end. And that's already the same. I said we will be looking at total energies and relative energies here, where relative energies is energies between a solid at equilibrium and expanded by some percent, 5%. So we have to do the calculation with some codes, and we chose these four codes out of, let's say, the 30 codes that's supported by NOMAD. There's two all electron codes, two pseudo potential codes. The reference basis was basically chosen by the experts or even developers of these codes. So FSIA uses atomic like orbitals. If you know this code, it's called TF2 basis set as a reference. Here's the pseudo potential code. Plane with plane waves. Here we use 1600 electron volts as the reference, and VASB is a little bit different. It comes with a recommended plane wave cutoff for each element, and maybe took the reference at 200% times this, which is, this should also be very accurate. All right, so of course, when we look at errors, so this is just to give you some concrete examples before we go into the statistics a little bit. So if you look at error from basis set first here, we're dealing with solids, we have to be dealing with rock states. So this is plane wave times a semi-periodic part here. And the semi-periodic part you can expand in some bases. So if it's a range, it'll be atomic-like orbitals. If it's a pseudo potential plane wave coach, it's plane waves. So just to write a complete expression here, plane wave basis set here. And the size of the space set is normally truncated by looking at the kinetic energy and defining a cutoff energy where we include all plane waves below this kinetic energy cutoff. So here I've brought two concrete examples. This is called oxygen. How the total energy converges with the plane wave cutoff. So you can see that oxygen starts up very high. This is a logarithmic scale, so this is exponential. It's the same for gold, but it starts much lower, and they sort of end up more or less close to each other here. The reason why oxygen is much higher is that it has more localized states or more rapidly varying states, so it needs a higher plane wave cutoff to converge that result. So this is just two simple examples. I should say that you can see the energies, they really vary by 4 as a technical limit when it's converted to synthesis. Starting at something like 10 electrovolts and going below mid electrovolts. A little bit large sort of energy changes you're talking about. So now this is the convergence. Oh, sorry, this is looking at the K points ending. So if you want to look at some observable, then you have a periodic system, you have to do an integration over the Boolean zone, which we approximated with some finite K points. And if you're uniform K points ending, then you find a parameter here, which is sort of the distance between your points in K space. So the higher the value, the more the K points you have. So this is a convergence parameter. And now we can look again at these two same elemental solids, gold and oxygen. And you can see that of course it decreases and it looks like it's exponential again. But now the roles are reversed. Gold is on top here and oxygen is below. And that's of course because gold is a metal, so it's harder to convert the K points, and this oxygen is insulated. And again, you can see that that is sort of orders of magnitudes changing energy. Okay, so that was just some simple examples. So now let's do a sort of building statistics and then averaging over all the materials. So what you see here is error in the total energy for these elemental solids. There's 4 panels. Each panel corresponds to a code. And there's two lines in this panel here. One is the mean absolute error, and the other one is the maximum error. So the maximum error has a label on this element that has the largest conversion error. Largest conversion error. I should say this is a function of basis set size here. So what we can note again, that it's kind of all across all codes, it's kind of similar that you start out with an error around 10 electron volts, and you go down below 3 electron volts and you do the convergence. This is with respect to some reference we have chosen, of course. So if we look at the relative energies, we can say that. So this was the energy difference between an expanded solid and a solid in equilibrium. We can say that, so you see the same curves as before, but now there's two new curves, this is blue and purple, that the error goes down by an order, two orders of magnitude for these relative errors because of some error cancellation in the basis or in the structures. So we want to have some numbers and everything what people say minimal basis that you can get the mean error below 1 millielectrovolt quite fast, and really we don't want to worry about anything smaller, but at least I don't. Alright, so this is the last slide of just looking at the errors. So here it's looking at the K point sampling. I don't want you to look at all the details, but you can pick a favorite color here. So for example, that big blue. If you look at all the blue bars, so they have the same height. So it means that all the codes have the similar average error with respect to K points. And this is also what you would expect. So and then that's good because it means that if you know the error can be some code or some basis set, then you can operate transfer it to something else, another code or another basis set. So let me just try to wrap up these observations here. So it's the same data, just plotting in a slightly different way. So what you see here is a percentage of materials that are not converged to given criteria as a function of the criteria. So just to take an example, let's say I'm interested in having convergence to the criteria of 50 millielectrovolts. What can I expect? Well, then it turns out that 60% of your materials are not converged if you use a bandwidth of 400 electrovolts. So it means you live with 40% to study if you really want to have the criteria for 50. You can say, I'm not happy with this. I want to increase the bandwidth cutoff. If you increase to 600 electrovolts, then you can see now it's only 20% that's not converged. have an hour, you can continue with it, with all the 80% that are converged. You could do the same with the K1 sampling, but all right, so that was just trying to get a feel for the error so they can verify what all this magnitude. So let's try to see if we can predict them in a simple way. So the first two equations here are just definitions, basically. So this is the energy of an atom A with some basis at small b. And then that should be equal to our reference energy, and that we can make it by adding some correction to this and error, essentially. You can write exactly the same expression here for the, let's say, binary. So the error we are interested in is, we're trying to use these elemental solids, so the atoms, basically, the errors in the atoms, to try and predict the errors of the binaries or any other. So we can calculate this error, of course, and we do that, but we would also like to try to make an estimation. We'll do some more advanced things here, but we just took simply saying that we add up the errors from atom A and atom B in this simple linear combination. So, of course, we can do more advanced things, but this is what we did first. And just to give you an idea why this might work, you can consider something like a heat of formation, which is an energy difference. If you insert the estimated error here, it turns out that the error we make on this estimate, on the estimated error, so to speak, is the basis set error on the heat of formation. And normally these are, we expect these to be small errors because error cancellation for the heat of formation. So hopefully we can predict some errors relatively good in this way. And this is the plot we see here. So this is the estimated error versus the actual error. And you can see that there are some correlation. The different colors here are different basis sets. And especially, Gbo here, it looks like it looks a pretty good correlation. So let's try and zoom in a little bit on Gbo here. So if we start in the inset here, so this is where I've got the actual error minus the estimated error. So it means that there's a lot of points around zero, so this is good. We'll do a good estimation. But you can also see there's something that is more far away, like 100 millimeters away. If you make a histogram of this plot, this is you see the main figure here, then we can assume this is sort of a Gaussian and has a standard deviation of 50 millivectors in this case. So what does that mean? So that means, for example, that we can predict this estimate of the error with sort of plus minus 50 millivectors. So of course, what is the actual error? So this was done as field at the next one column. So the average error is 1600 milli-electron-volt, meaning we are trying to predict some error on the order of electron volts with, let's say, 50 milli-electron-volt accuracy. I think that's pretty decent. So here is kind of a test set. So it says binaries up here, it's just ternaries. So this is 10 systems we took randomly from NOMAD, so with the same people on that, and again we see a simple prediction is worked to some extent. Okay, so now let's try and take the use these errors for something. So let's say I've looked at this phase of NOMAD 2, calculated with the color of a field electron volt, and the other phase were calculated with 800 electron-volts. Then I made a small back of the envelope calculation here. So it's just total energy. It doesn't really mean anything, this number. The total energy here, and we subtract and we get half a volt. So this suggests that the A phase should be more stable than the T phase by half a volt. But this was for different basis, so let's try to add our estimated corrections with error bars. So T phase was the bad basis set, so that's a large correction. relatively large drop up here. And in the end, if we go through, we find that we can estimate, we get an estimated energy difference of 4.9 volt, which is pretty close actually to the reference calculation, and we have this error bar, so I think this probably say this is certainly the most stable case, even with these very different basis. All right, so now let me change gear a little bit. So this is going away from the numerical errors and into the XE errors. So I'll assume that all of them converge over our calculation with numerics and just looking at the exchange correlation errors. Of course, one can think about doing this in different ways, with machine learning or advanced data analytics. One approach is this, and this has been done with our department, is using a Bayesian learning screen, and it's first a little bit to it. So it's essentially take an example of enhancement factor. So this is the green curve. This is what defines the PDA functional. So you can see one curve here is PBE and one is RBB, and then there's this ensemble of curves here. And then the width here is chosen so that you when you do a calculation, you can get error bars on your observables. So what previously done is people have really tried to come up with new functionals. We're not interested in that. We just want to predict an error bar. So what we do is that we make a sort of ensembles here where I say PD is the mean. Okay, and then when we use that, some fitting to experimental data to come up with some error bars for all DA, PB, RPB, whatnot. So here's an example taken from this paper here. So if you do the calculation, let's say these affinity with all these functionals, you get this large spread of values. If you instead do the energy difference between BTC and FTC, this is for copper, you get a much smaller spread. So you can see that the estimated error on the cohesive energy is like 500 millivolt, and the BTC one FTC is only 5 millivolt. So you know, even there are some quantities with DFT, as a large error, you can even, I mean, there are some that are less. So this is what people compared to experiments that actually works, and you can say this estimation works in this case. So now we try to apply this to the binaries. So what you see here is the experimental heat of formation versus the calculated heat of formation. Now with error bars on, and you can see that at least some of the error bars they incorporate the experimental one. Well, here you just see this just to get a feeling for the spread of the error bars. So they're sort of estimated error sort of 200 millivolts from the DJs. I should say that the DJ is very simple, so that, for example, this system up here is very far off and we don't do a very good prediction of the error bar, but this is, as soon as you have some physics that's not in DJ, will also be found in bars, then you cannot really probe it with this ensemble of functionals, and you cannot predict a good error. So I think that's okay, because if you could do that, you probably also know how to make a much better functional. So this is just a little bit of statistics. So if we're doing a good job on the error estimation, then this blue histogram should look like a Gaussian, and there's some systematic shift, and there's some tears up here which come from the physics missing, but overall it looks okay. All right, so let's return to silicon before we end here. So we sort of established that the numerical errors here are probably well converged. So here I've tried to add this error estimation on the lattice constant of silicon. You can see that is actually pretty large, and it incorporates the experimental values, so at least in this case, it will have the experimental error bar. And it's much larger than the numerical error, and that's where we want to be. All right, so this is the conclusions. So I talked about that we can basically say, okay, controlled and predicted reasonable with this simple scheme using the atoms. We looked at the K-point sampling errors. The good thing is they're comparable across codes. They're pretty hard to estimate. For example, you know, metals are very different from semiconductors, so we don't do that just from the elements. We'll have to know about the band gap and so on. And then finally, there was this outlook on XC errors. And they can be estimated, but of course it doesn't work if the physics is not really profiled or included in the GTA. So finally, there's some acknowledgement here. So this is all the people that have helped out. And thank you for the attention.